Hey guys, in this video we're going to cover the basics of hypothesis testing. If you want to learn what hypothesis testing is, what the testing process looks like, want to understand the concepts such as the null and the alternative hypothesis, or type 1 and type 2 errors, alpha and beta, then this is the right video for you. Let's first talk about the concept of a hypothesis. So essentially, a hypothesis is any statement that can be tested. In science, you will see a lot of hypotheses formulated with the if-then pattern. For example, if hydrogen is mixed with oxygen, it explodes. And the part that says that it can be tested essentially adheres to the main principle, or one of the main principles of science, as outlined by Mr. Karl Popper, which is the principle of falsifiability. In statistics, we are interested in a more specific type of hypothesis called the statistical hypothesis, which is a testable statement about some population parameter. Another important point that needs to be made is that a hypothesis is different from a theory. And this is a common misconception. Those two concepts are used synonymously. However, a theory is made from the position of knowledge. It's backed by ample evidence and empirical data, whereas a hypothesis is made from the position of ignorance. So it's more akin to an educated guess, where you're suggesting that this is worth researching further. This is something that needs to be looked into. Now let's talk about hypothesis testing and what its place is in science, and more specifically in statistics. So hypothesis testing is itself a method of statistical inference, and statistical inference is when we take a sample from a population and we analyze the data to make inferences about the properties of that population we took the sample from. And of course, it should be obvious by now that hypothesis testing is really indispensable to the scientific method itself. Now that we've discussed the what, we can discuss the how of hypothesis testing, and by that I mean the testing process. And it starts with stating the null and alternative hypothesis, and we'll discuss those two guys in just a second. However, once you have those two, you select appropriate significance levels, which will be covered in the next video about significance. And once you have that down, you are going to select the appropriate test statistic. And when you have calculated the test statistics with a corresponding test, you're going to compare that to your significance. Again, those last three steps are going to be discussed in a separate video on significance levels. And we'll discuss p-values as well, we'll discuss test statistics and all of that jazz. However, for now, just try to get the general idea of what's going on. And once we compare the test statistics to significance, we are then able to make a decision about our hypothesis. So we'll see a little bit later in this video that with the null and alternative hypothesis, we're either going to reject the null or fail to reject the null. Let's finally talk about the null and the alternative hypothesis. And in any hypothesis test you're going to be making, you will see those two guys, the null and the alternative, and they are always the two competing possibilities. And of course, science is very much about progress, but it's also about making very, very careful decisions and being very conservative with your analysis. And because of that, the null hypothesis, which is denoted as H0, or H naught, something you're also going to hear sometimes, it represents the status quo. So the null hypothesis is always given a bit more weight because you really gotta prove your point if you're trying to accept the alternative. And of course, everybody's going to favor things as they are in the present. And that's why the null is generally assumed to be true, whereas the alternative hypothesis, which is denoted as HA for alternative, in case you haven't guessed that yourself, it's also called the research hypothesis. And this guy has to be proven to be accepted. And statisticians really don't take that task lightly. You have to go out of your way to make your point with the data and with the analysis. And this is very famously compared to the process of a court trial and the famous presumption of innocence, where the null hypothesis would be that the defendant is assumed to be innocent until they are proven guilty. Now let's take a look at some examples. Here's the first one. The mean entry-level salary of an employee at a company is $50,000. You believe it is higher for IT professionals in the company. Think about it for a second. What could be our null hypothesis in this case, and what could be our alternative hypothesis? So the null is that the salary is actually the same for IT professionals as it is for all other employees. So it's $50,000 or perhaps less. However, the alternative hypothesis, which we are trying to prove, is that the salary is actually strictly higher than $50,000. So the second example is a household chemicals manufacturer that claims that their product kills 99.9% of the germs. You've probably heard that one before. And of course, you suspect that the number may be lower. Again, think about it. What is the null and what is the alternative? And so the null hypothesis is that the mean equals to 99.9% and the manufacturer is not lying, and their product indeed does what they claim it does. However, the alternative hypothesis is that the product kills less than that. So now we'll talk about type 1 and type 2 errors, which are two of the four possible outcomes when we do our hypothesis testing. Type 1 error is when we reject a good null. So the null is true, however, we think we found data that warrants rejecting the null, and we're wrong to do so. That produces a type 1 error, which is also known as the false positive, and it is denoted as alpha. And the second possible case is that the null is false, and we are then correct to reject it. No error here. The third possible outcome is not rejecting a true null, which is again correct. And the last possible outcome, as you might have guessed, would be a type 2 error, and that would be not rejecting a false null. The type 2 error is also known as the false negative, and it is denoted as beta. Now let's go back to our examples and see what the type 1 and type 2 errors could be for each. In case with IT professionals and their salary, type 1 error would be believing that the salary is higher for IT professionals when it is not. And a type 2 error would then be deciding that the salary is not higher for IT professionals, that it equals to the mean salary, when in fact it is indeed higher. However, we fail to reject our null hypothesis, and we are wrong to do so. The second example with the household chemicals would be, let's think about it. So it has to be a false positive, and that means that we reject a good null. And in our case, rejecting a good null would entail accepting that the product kills less than 99.9% of the germs, when in fact it does kill, as advertised, 99 and 9% of the germs. Whereas the type 2 error would be concluding that the 99.9% of the germs are killed when they aren't. Thank you guys for watching. Hopefully you found the video useful, and if you did, please consider subscribing and check out other videos on our channel.